scene.
Thank you.
I don't know whether you've seen it. ISD has tweeting Jonathan Slider. I'm not having. Okay, I just want to.
Nobody is listening. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. I was expecting to see 250 people because that's what I have in my list, and the number of registered delegates. But nonetheless, let's warm up today. Really, my name is Lee Uemajele Sibanda, and I'll be your co-facilitator today.
My name is Alexander Müller. I'm your co-facilitator today, and I'm positively surprised to see so many people here. Because, you know, there was a long party, and there are some people in the room here in the last row who came directly from the party to the opening here, and therefore I'm
excellent. Excellent. So we've all warmed up, stayed up for the party, had a good time. So I'm keen to know. Day one, day two, day three, knowledge. Alexander, what's your big ticket? What are you taking home today?
The next steps, and also to present the lessons we have learned so far. You know, I'm also curious, what is your one sentence you have learned yesterday in this meeting? And then I'm going to present my sentence.
I'm taking home this.
What is this?
Hug the teddy bear. Hug the cube. Hug the cube and be audible. That's what is living in my mind. But on a serious note, I think for me what came out here is the issue of state and non-state actors. We need more government engagement. We need more space for civil society. And I think if the two worlds meet, we are done. That's my big thing.
What I'm trying to do now is to explain the process or to present the roadmap from Berlin to New York, the High Level Political Forum, and maybe beyond. And the first question is, someone asked yesterday, about, are you always talking about giving the message and the results to New York? What's the idea behind? And I would like to present three or four brief ideas why we have to bring the results of this conference, of this global summit in 2017 to New York. First of all, the high-level political forum in New York has some weaknesses. And one of the major weaknesses, from my perspective, is it is not linked to what is happening at local level. These are global negotiations, of course, but we would like to bring action and messages from the local level to the high-level political forum in order to provide a linkage between the levels. We want the high-level political forum to be informed by the work you are doing on the ground. And on the other way, we would like to bring the global messages to the action on the ground. We cannot afford to de-link it, and therefore The first and most important issue is we want to strengthen the linkages between the high-level political forum and action at national level, and we want to include experiences from the ground. Second message, very strong from my perspective, is in July in New York, they're going to discuss SDG 2 on food security. We have to ensure that the review of the SDGs will be done in an integrated way. For me, the key word yesterday was integration. We should not allow this review process to work in a silo-oriented mode to say, this is my SDG, I'm going to work on it. And therefore, we have to deal with complex issues in a cross-cutting way, and therefore integration is the key word. So, first message, first reason why we are doing it, strengthening linkages between global level and action on the ground. Second is integration to ensure that cross-cutting issues will be tackled. Third reason, very strong, the SDGs have been developed in broad partnerships. Without these broad partnerships and the participatory approach, the SDGs would not exist. And therefore, we have to ensure that the same is valid also for the implementation. Partnerships are key. So linking global at local level. Second, integration, third, ensuring partnerships will play an important role for the implementation. And the fourth reason is, especially in the workshops on the first and morning of the second day, we again got the strong message that we have to integrate all forms of knowledge, scientific knowledge, traditional knowledge, experience from farmers, in order to implement the SDGs. And while doing it, we are going to identify new research questions, and therefore, implementation of SDGs is knowledge intensive, but this does not mean only peer-reviewed articles. This means taking all forms of knowledge into account. So these are the four reasons why we want to go to New York. But what are we going to present in New York? And this has been developed only yesterday. If you look at Twitter, you can see a lot of nice, very brief stories. One of the stories was healthy nutrition starts with healthy soils, or nutrition starts with soils. And therefore, our idea is to bring five of these very brief stories to New York, explaining what we have discussed here. So not lengthy paragraphs, lengthy reports, but five brief stories. And I would like to present these five brief stories. The first one is nutrition starts with soils. And we can produce maybe a nice video for it. The second was SDGs are the missing piece of globalization. We cannot live in a globalized world where sustainability is localized. So this is the second story. The third story, we had quite a strong influence from the ocean community, and therefore coastal fisheries depend on sustainable land management to curb pollution. Bringing cross-cutting issues in one of the stories. Story number four, access to land and healthy soils can reduce pressure to migrate and are part of the solution, especially for young people. We had quite a complex debate on the relationship between migration perspectives for young people, and of course we know that access to land is only part of the solution, but it's an important part. And someone made a very strong comment and said equal access to land for women would reduce hunger by at least 30%. I put by at least 30% in reference because we have to have intelligence to find out if we have a reference. But these five stories we would like to present to New York as flashlights. And these are the overarching five stories. And then we are going to present high-level messages from here. And DV is going to present them. But additionally, this is important for all of you who are working, who have worked so very much in the workshops. We will have a summary of this global soil meeting, where we roll out what has been discussed in the workshops, and we will have a full report. But of course, you cannot go with a full report to New York. Nobody's going to listen if you read a 20-page report. But it has to be documented so that we see all your input, and it can be used as an important layer to continue. continue the discussion. And very important, and I have to say, I have learned it from our colleagues from the African Solid Seminar. We are also going to bring the results of the African Solid Seminar across the planet. This is a document which has been endorsed by governments, and we also have to find a way to invite representatives of the governments to also participate. So that we are not talking about participation theory only, but we want really to bring participants also to the group. So we have a complex structure, 5 stories, 5 high-level messages to be presented by BDB, and a lot of background material. And we all want to bring it to New York, including representatives of the countries who have prepared the Stone and Soil Meeting and who have worked on the African Soil Seminar. Does this make sense to you so far?
It does, but what comes out here is that instead of taking this whole big report, we need to own some key messages that we can speak to, and just by the raising of the palm, we can speak to 5 key messages that we will not only take away from this big meeting to our constituencies, but take back to New York. Now, what are these 5 key messages? Number one, what are we talking about? We need investment, so let's start there. We need to increase investment in responsible land governance and monitor them. We need the investment, they've got to be increased for responsible land governance, but most important, accountability. We need to monitor these investments, number one. Number two, our consumption patterns, all of us, we need to change, particularly the high-consuming countries, because they are responsible for land degradation in other parts of the world. This has got to change. Consumption patterns, high-consuming countries, the impact they are having in terms of land degradation in other parts of the world. Our voice has to be heard, and we demand a change in that area. Message number 3, take home. There is an urgent need for spatial planning addressing the rural-urban continuum in an integrated way. Let's stop this divide. Let's have spatial planning that addresses the continuum rural-urban in an integrated way. That's our message number 3. Number 4, we need an improvement in land tenure and land rights for vulnerable people. Why? Because human rights are under pressure because of the shrinking space for civil society. Improved land tenure and land rights for vulnerable people is a must, because human rights are under pressure and the shrinking space for civil society is a issue. Number 5. We need to build a bridge between SDG 2 and SDG 15.3 so as to ensure food security by rehabilitation of degraded soils, achieving land degradation neutrality, and managing landscapes for people. What are the entry points for these? Number 1, community empowerment. Number 2, accountable and high-level extension services that embrace the youth. And number 3, open data access. Ladies and gentlemen, those are the 5 high-level messages that we are proposing. I'm sure if we're going through the 5, some of you are itching to say, oh no, I don't agree with that, or you left out one key one, a burning one.
Gender, fisheries, and forests, not to forget, in the context of food security. So either it might be good to include it in the high-level messages, or you have it as kind of a backup.
Thank you.
Yes, also congratulations from my side. That's very excellent. It provides a brilliant, brilliant framework for the messages. Comment on point three a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Phrase it, yes, need for special planning. I would go for a little broader concept and say we'll go for territorial approaches. This is not an advertisement, just with reference to a keyword done by FAO, OECD, and the UN Capital Development Fund on adopting a territorial approach to food security and nutrition policy. That these institutions, I think, could be great allies if we want to try to bring partners together. Here they are. Territorial approaches is far more than just spatial planning. It's on regional policy and regional planning. And this is far more than just a, let's say, a planner sitting somewhere and drawing a plan. It is a political process. Yeah? And in this political process where a community agrees to delineate preferential uses for certain areas, that could be a key concept bringing our interest. You don't want me to talk too long.
Thank you. This is harvest time. We are collecting your contributions and there will be invited respondents. But for now, any framing, any phrasing you don't agree with, this is your time. Any other comments? Is that a hand?
Yeah.
All right. Two.
Now you know how it works.
It works faster.
Yeah. First of all, also let me congratulate you to these five key messages. I think they are very, very important. And probably the entry point to sustainable land management. But quite a few of us in the room here are biophysical scientists. And I'm wondering, let's imagine just for a second, these five things were implemented. Does that automatically lead to sustainable land management, to conserving soils? Or is there a biophysical component, management practices, best practices to manage soils? Are we confident that this automatically happens once this is in place? And that's why I guess.
All right, so we put a new lens to say we'll get us to our destination. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Just a very small
comment. Up the game.
Small comment. I only see one vulnerable people mentioned. I would like to see also women's rights, for example, gender mentioned more prominently because they always can decide that.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. As a land rights movement, my concern is to see whether the process of SDGs is a real shift in the consciousness or not. If it's not a shift in the consciousness, then there are certain degree of risk and uncertainties which is there. The first concern is the translation of all loud messages of SDGs in domestic policies, legislations, and the practices, which is still unanswered, and I think in New York, we need to challenge this. Thank you.
Point
well
made. That's round two. Cute. This side.
This is my first time getting to hug the box. I was surprised that the word production never came up. I see sustainable consumption and also mention of land management. Because I think mentioning production somewhere is important because often consumption is the result of things that are happening upstream in the food system and often with little choice. And so while sustainable consumption is very important, I would hopefully like to see production somewhere else.
No, microphone up.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, I also would like to mention that I just have also one to support the looking up the language of the vulnerable group, just like, for example, the women. Because for indigenous people, we're not just vulnerable groups, we're actual time rights holders and using that their vulnerable groups hide us and makes us even more invisible. So I think we need to think that the use of vulnerable groups as hiding those who are actually left behind. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for those contributions. Continue thinking and reflecting. We're in the process. Pia, is your hand up?
Well, thank you very much. I am really impressed that you managed to capture the discussion of 2 days in these high-level messages. And of course, every one of us would like to see its own subject reflected. But these are really good messages, and I would encourage you to keep them. Thank you.
Thank you, Pia. Thank you very much. There's a burning point at the back there. I don't want to leave anyone behind. So, madam, over to you.
Be careful.
The chair will top over.
Yeah. Also, thank you for these messages, which I think are broad enough, but also specific. Mine is on the metric. Number 4, about the shrinking space for civil society engagement. And I think the civic space is much broader than the civil society and the promotion and protection of human rights has many actors, including national human rights institutions, human rights defenders, local communities. So perhaps it's good to broaden that so that it includes the many actors who are involved in the human rights agenda.
Thank you. Excellent. So we need to broaden. My apologies. So that we see more actors. But one of the key actors in the rule of law, in governance, in creating a conducive policy environment is government, right? So we are honored today because we have government representatives amongst us, and we are keen to hear what are their high-level messages. Do they endorse these? Do they take away and add? Have we left something? And we want to put them on the center spot here. Number one, Madame Jean Josette Akasha Akoma. You spoke on day one. This is your time to share with us your reflection. In just 3 minutes, take us to the dreamland where there is no more pain. Over to you.
Particulièrement heureuse d'avoir participé à cette semaine
mondiale du sol, parce que toutes les discussions qui sont passées ici, je me suis sentie complètement à l'aise. Et quand j'ai vu les messages qui nous ont été présentés aujourd'hui, je suis d'accord avec ces messages, parce que pour nous autres, qui sommes de l'environnement, moi je me sens complètement partie intégrante de tous les acteurs ici présents, de la gestion durable des terres, parce que pour nous, c'est très important que nous changions de paradigme. Il faut changer de paradigme parce que nous ne pouvons plus aujourd'hui, si nous devons aller dans la gestion, vers la gestion durable des ressources naturelles, dont la gestion des terres, nous devons établir des ponts. Nous ne devons plus évoluer. Tout à l'heure, le mot silo est sorti, nous ne devons plus évoluer en silo. Nous devons établir des ponts. C'est pour cela que je suis parfaitement d'accord avec ce qui a été présenté. Et il y a aussi un terme qui est sorti dans les messages, la notion de gouvernance et de liberté. C'est très important. Ce sont des notions qui nous sont chères parce qu'en tant que représentants du gouvernement, nous avons à adopter des lois et des règlements et surtout nous assurer de leur mise en œuvre, de leur application. Parce que les problèmes que nous avons, pourquoi nous sommes réunis ici ce matin, c'est parce que nous n'avons pas appliqué les réglementations. Si les actions que nous menions avaient pris en compte l'environnement et le social, nous aurons déjà des terres qui seront moins dégradées. Donc la gestion durable des terres serait déjà d'actualité. Nous devons aussi mettre en place un cadre institutionnel pour permettre une gestion durable des terres. Je voudrais alors parler aussi de la liberté. Hier et avant-hier, nous avons parlé des droits de l'homme. Les hommes ont droit à respirer de l'air sain, à manger sain. Et tout ceci est lié à la qualité du sol. Nous avons droit de boire une eau propre. Donc si les sols ne sont pas gérés de manière durable, l'eau aussi est polluée. Avec l'interconnexion avec les océans, tel qu'on nous a dit hier, nous avions un collègue qui était situé par là, c'est pas là où il est ce matin, qui nous avait parlé de tout ce que nous avons comme pêcherie au niveau des océans. Mais toi, nous ne sommes pas passés, j'espère. Hein? Et donc nous avons, pour moi, je pense que nous devons travailler ensemble. Tous les ministères, tous les acteurs ici doivent être en symbiose avec les ministères en charge de l'environnement. Si nous continuons de faire comme nous sommes en train de faire, il y a de bonnes pratiques et nous devons les dupliquer. Et les mauvaises pratiques, nous devons les corriger. Nous devons être, pour moi, nous devons être en symbiose avec tous les acteurs. Donc, il est important de prendre en compte l'environnement et le social, l'inclusion, les femmes, les jeunes. Toutes ces questions seront résolues. Si on avait au préalable pris en compte le respect de l'homme environnemental et social. C'est le premier volet de ma présentation. Je vous ai dit que vous allez les
Merci beaucoup.
Mais ça, je voudrais vous parler de ce désir. Vous n'en voulez plus?
Actually, I'd like just to clarify how we're going to use the Slido for this session. Like yesterday, we're going to have the questions running in the background and the participants yourself or even the presenters can pick the questions if you need it. These questions are, of course, we recorded and we're going to work on that later. But we also have a pool, a survey on the background. You can also find it at Slido. When you have the five policy messages that were just presented, and you can rate those messages from 1 to 5 stars. Okay, so those that you like more, you give 1 stars, and those you like less, you give 1 star. And then we're going to compile this information for the final report. So I think we can keep it in the background, and this is also valid information for us later to synthesize the knowledge that we are producing here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. From Benin, I'd like to take you to Cameroon. And in Cameroon, we've got a new actor, Madame Claudette Clemence Bamzo Mbobe. You are new to this process, and when you come out of here, you're going to do some radical transformation. This is your spot to take us to Cameroon. Thank you.
Merci. Je suis Madame Bamzo Mbobe, directeur du développement de l'agriculture. Dans ce cadre, moi j'ai retenu quelque chose qui s'inscrit dans la durabilité, c'est d'abord la jeunesse, mais aussi le renforcement des capacités des producteurs à travers les services de vulgarisation. Donc, dans ce cadre, le ministère de l'Agriculture a 24 écoles de formation. Au niveau des techniciens d'agriculture, nous avons 4 universités agricoles. Je pense que le principal message serait de renforcer les curricula dans la formation de ceux qui sont chargés d'encadrer les producteurs sur le terrain. Et je m'y emploierai. Merci.
Cameron, capacity building, that's the way to go. Thank you very much, Cameron. Merci beaucoup. Now from Cameroon to Ethiopia. Ethiopia, Madame Almaz Mesele Massa. Congratulations on the new Director General for the World Health Organization.
In order to incorporate this one in policy,
and also it required some operational issues there in order to implement some operational level issues also there, and also on 2 days discussion, what I pick up from our discussion is that about coordination. I think in order to get some solution about soil, coordination is an important one. So monitoring and evaluation is there. That's our problem, because in our country we do have set problems. So high officials may discuss on that, and we look forward for some change about soil. Really, it's my first time to attend on such occasions. Really, I appreciate. And we are, as because as a worldwide, the soil problem, when problem of soil is in Ethiopia, may pose some impact on Kenya and the like. So it is better to touch, to coordinate together. So that is my message. And already, I, as a representative of Ethiopia, I accept all the five mentioned areas. Thank you very much.
Of land rights, of protection of natural resources
come together, not just in a plan, not just in a project, but in a political process. And in the end, development is not a question of projects, it's a question of a process. Thank you very much. Well, Ethiopia say what happens in soils in Ethiopia affects Kenya and the whole world. And Janet says, it's going to happen in Berlin every year. Is it a reality? Thank you so much. We are in it together. And we are going to make sure our voices are heard globally. But more important for now, we are taking them to New York with the key messages that have been endorsed. And government representatives, go back to your own constituency and make sure they know what happened in Berlin. But for all of us, non-government, civil society actors, go to your constituencies because we are good at reminding government what it has to do. So we are in it together. Let's take the messages back home for endorsement. Now, let's move from Germany to Mexico, where I am honored to Guatemala. I'm sorry. To Guatemala, where we are honored to have Ambassador Jose Francisco Calintay, who is going to share with us his own experiences, but more important, what they do in Guatemala. Thank you so much.
I don't want us to have problems, diplomatic problems with Mexico. So. And the thing is that as a government representative, I can say that in principle, human rights, we support all what can we see in the international arena. But we have to discuss also inside Guatemala, among the other authorities, among the other institutions, so we can see to agree to support all the other all the issues that you are discussing here. But as I say, in principle, we support. What I can share with you is that what we need is, and we discussed yesterday, legal security or security for land. When we are talking about soil, we cannot talk only about soil. We have to talk about also under soil, natural resources. And that means that we have to be, to have more control on the transnationals. And what we have to do is also to ask governments to control their transnational and to behave and to respect legal instruments that they have in their own country, overseas. Because if not, they can do, because you know that in our country, especially Latin America, Asia, and Africa, are very weak frame legal, or the legal frame that we have, they are very weak. So that's why we have to ask those countries, to ask those transnational to respect their own law in their country, overseas, to behave as they are working in other countries. What we have to talk about also is protected areas. Because the protected areas, sometimes they name or their are going to declare protected areas where people are living. And they are not taking into account that those people are the ones who have been taking care of those protected areas, especially indigenous peoples. It was mentioned this morning. And I can tell you, 87% of the biodiversity that is still in the world is in on indigenous people territories. So that's why we have to take care on the traditional way of protecting soil of the indigenous people. Because as the co-moderator was saying, my experience is that at least in Guatemala, and also in south of Mexico, we use three ways of protecting soil. Use cultivating corn, cultivating cabbages. No, not cabbages. Pumpkins and beans. Beans is going to bring that is going to be used by the corn, and pumpkins is going to protect the soil. So that will not be degraded the soil. So that is why we use the three elements that is very important for us. And what we are going to say, what I'm going to say is that when you are saying that the civil society needs more space, let me tell you, no government is going to give more space to civil society. If civil society doesn't stop. That is my experience when I was working in the civil society. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot to the representatives of government. Thanks a lot to you, Stefan, announcing we are going to continue to support the Global Soil Week. Maybe we are not going to have a meeting every year, but we will continue to work Global Soil Week as a platform with these meetings and as a process. And this combination, we are really grateful that you have supported us right from the beginning and you publicly have announced this project can continue, and I'm really happy that we can use this as a basis to foster our collaboration. Before we are going now to the three invited experts, I would like to ask Mateus to guide us a little bit through the questions, because you know, you can use your little devices or your laptops not to do your private emails, but to comment on what you can see here and to like or not like some of the issues raised. Mateus, where are we in the ranking of the most important questions here?
Thanks, Alexander. The interaction is pretty good. We have 22 questions already addressed. There are two questions that received a number of positive votes here. I think it would be interesting to bring them together, which is this one on changing production and consumption patterns. Annie was asking, okay, if changing production is the goal, production and consumption is the goal, what are the key policy and regulatory measures to get there? And I think that matches also the question on if this changing consumption production of high-income countries can only happen in partnership with low-income countries through triangular and south-south partners. It's up to you to decide to whom you should address this question, but I think maybe it fits our colleague from Germany, no?
Yes, that would be one option. But let's do it in a way that we are asking for a brief comment from the north and a brief comment from the south. And let's start with the south. Who, coming from the south, and this does not mean Bavaria in Germany, in the south, who wants to provide two or three sentences as an answer to it? So we all agree, but how? Is there any idea? And if nobody raises his or her hand, yes, we just throw the microphone.
To the least tempted.
Yeah. This might be hard to work. So he's so yes, just throw it somewhere. Someone will catch it and he or she will have the answer. For you. So the question is, how are we going to change consumption patterns?
We are. I'm going to speak first. So
yes.
Yeah. Okay. The changement Afrique, cette aide-là soit estimée en fonction des revenus entre 5 et 75% des récoltes. Je pense que c'est un élément important de maîtrise donc, de ce cycle de production et de consommation. En ce qui concerne les pays développés, dans les pays du Nord, je pense qu'on pourra mieux maîtriser les comportements de consommation et de production des rendre mieux durables. Et si nous arrivons à éviter aussi les énormes gaspillages que l'on observe, surtout en ce qui concerne les produits qui viennent à leur date de périssement et qui sont observés dans les grands surfaces, dans les deux communautés. Donc, il est important d'avoir effectivement une bonne coopération de voir comment est-ce que ces produits, au lieu de les laisser périr, arriver à échéance en termes de consommation dans les pays développés, comment est-ce qu'on s'assure de façon optimale que les pays soient en manque, qu'ils soient disposés. Voilà un peu sur le vif que je voulais répondre. Merci.
Alexander, I just want to make a contribution. I was in Tanzania last week, and you know the big contribution in Tanzania was always Kilimanjaro, which is agriculture first. But they coined a new one, and I had to change it up. It's Kula Kwa Afya, Si Kwa Nja. Those who speak Swahili would understand.
All of us understand.
So it means eat for health, not for hunger. I think that's how we can reduce overconsumption.
Brief comment.
Well, you comment on sustainable production and consumption. The first point. Need to continue lobbying and advocating for the for fair prices of what we consume. The concept of fairness going far beyond just fair labor, fair wages, but fair in the sense of sustainable use of the natural resources. Global value chains in that are absolutely key, and we need to continue our work in this regard. We start here with fair trade labels, for example, and we have to continue and improve that work to make sure that fairness makes far more than just social justice, but also the internalization of the consumption of natural resources.
Thanks a lot, Stefan, for this comment. And I think this is a perfect bridge to our next speaker, Barbara Unmüßig from the Heinrich Böll Foundation here in Berlin, but with offices all over the world. And I would be very surprised, Barbara, if you would not pick up the question of fair trade and try to link it to the debate we had so far. We have 3 minutes. Sometimes 3 hours
before. Okay. Thank you very much, I would like to congratulate you very much so for the key messages. I think they are very appropriate to bring it to the high-level forum in New York. I very much would like as well to refer to consumption patterns. The Heinrich Böll Foundation published the so-called Meat Atlas. The distribution in Germany is about 500,000 copies. And that makes me sure that this is something we have to do. Campaign, give people information, what are the ecological and social footprints of meat consumption, and inform our consumers here in Germany, for example. And I think this is inform, raise awareness about the ecological and social footprint through our meat consumption is the way to get people to reduce per capita consumption. This is something that has to happen. In Germany, a person eats still 16 kilos per year. I think this is much too high. We do not campaign for not eating meat, but to reduce it. And to reduce it and to come up with a more sustainable consumption, that's what I think we all should do together. And the Meat Atlas is a very good tool. Coming January, we are going to publish an atlas on solutions, and this will definitely mean to bring up very clear recommendations and demands how to achieve what we would like to have sustainable agriculture. The second issue I would like to bring forward, and this is something I do miss a bit in your five recommendations. If we really would like that the SDGs are becoming guidelines for policy, then we have to address agricultural trade policy and future investment. And I would like to see that the SDGs are more and more becoming the guiding principles for trade policies and for investment policies. Huge amounts of investments are going to developing countries in the coming years. Specifically, African countries are becoming the last frontier of huge industrial agricultural investment. And we have to discuss this, and we have to bring, if we discuss silos, we have to get rid of that world where is the UN coming up with value-based, sustainable goals, and on the other hand, we have a trade policy, financial and investment policies that undermine what has been or what we try to achieve within the UN or through the SDGs. The third issue is and this is what I have been talking about on Monday, without access to land, without the guarantee of fundamental human rights, like the freedom of participation, the freedom of expression, the freedom to assemble, we will lose the struggle. And we have to speak up wherever we are what is currently taking place. The space for civil society is shrinking everywhere, not only in authoritarian governments, but as well in democratic or semi-authoritarian governments. And this is something we have really to address wherever we are. Put this issue on the agenda all the time, because without access to information, access to meet, access to participation, we will lose the battle between what I have been talking before. Do we get a sustainable agriculture, an inclusive one, a fair one, or do we continue with the agricultural, industrial agricultural model that will spoil the soil and will destruct the livelihood of the people? Thank you.
Barbara, there is one open question. You mentioned the meat atlas. Someone from behind where I was sitting said, isn't there also a soil atlas?
Yeah, that's true.
Do you know how many copies have been distributed, not only in Germany, but at a global scale? Wow. Just cheap because you forgot it.
Yeah, no. I didn't forget it, but I have to save time, so sorry. The soil atlas is outside, and we have more than 200,000 copies. 200,000 copies distributed globally. That was your question, wasn't it?
So thanks a lot. Yes, this is what I wanted to know. Now our next speaker is Günter Bachmann, the Secretary General of the Council for Sustainable Development. And this council, and especially Günter as a person, they are playing a very important role in connecting civil society with independent advisory bodies. If you look at the architecture of sustainability, we are talking about governance, we're talking about science, we're talking about civil society, but there are independent advisory bodies in Germany, in Europe, all over the world, and connecting these independent bodies and preparing kind of a shadow report on what has been achieved is one of the work streams that you have been doing. So 3 to 5 minutes to inform us on this work stream and all the other things you will sit down.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I will start with all the other issues. Going back to 1978, I left university at the time. I was jobless, an academic with some knowledge about soils, more or less jobless. 20 years later, we had the soil protection legislation in Germany. exposed to lead or cadmium on while playing in the playground, they have to be protected. And we came up with a figure. We came up with a figure for this. And my question is, would that be of any difference if this child plays in Uganda or in Kenya or wherever? Why don't we use these kind of figures to maintain and support our common cause? So be concrete. Be very concrete. You can do this. And be bold. We are still asking for more metrics, standards for soils in the production line. And as, of course, soil is an issue for land management. But we know that the majority of people are living in the cities. So we need to go urban with the soil issues. We have to ask, where is the new soil in urban environments? How can we produce soil? This is new frontiers, of course. And that is why I think we're going to have to think anew the soil issue from the perspective of urbanism. The fifth crusade is what we used to call the roof, where we have to grow vegetables and have soils reproducing themselves. Collecting, Alex, the key word that you presented me with is how to connect. But one lesson here is integration is about connecting and challenging both. There's no way to just stay outside the building and knock on the door and say, oh, I want to be integrated. It's us. Connect yourself and then challenge the environment. There are already standards for sustainable investment. And you made this point, I think it was the first point in investments, increased investments. Yeah. And how would we relate to these existing standards? We can easily point the finger on multilateral corporations if they're dodging their responsibility. Yes, but there's the other side as well. There are people out there doing reasonable financing schemes into sustainable solutions. And where does the soil come in? That's connecting and challenging. There, in your countries, there are the auditing committees or auditing institutions. They are now beginning to set up a scheme in order to prove the preparedness of governments and the society to deliver against sustainable development goals. Where does the soil? They are looking into these issues. Land grabbing would be one answer, of course, but there would be other answers needed as well. The German Supreme Auditing Institution is now checking what we're doing nationally in Germany in terms of delivering against the SDGs. We're well prepared here because Germany has already redesigned and relaunched its sustainable development strategy in January this year. And this new strategy is mapping on the SDGs, both in the international linkage and on the national side. And this is what we did here as government, is, or as Germany, is that this strategy invites civil society and the council as well to have a say within this territory. And we are still increasing the way civil society is having a say in the national SD strategy. That is why we as a council are trying to connect those in the world that have a similar role compared to what we are doing in Germany. Now we created this open SDG club.Berlin habits in November last year. It was not the last one. and we will redo this. And for all this end of the this kind of meetings and gatherings here, the Soil Week, it's very important to have a sponsor for this. And I can only congratulate the board of BMZ for this announcement here. That would not mean that it's only the BMZ, the Ministry for the International Cooperation. If you need some help from our side, we can do this together and press other departments. like some scientists, in a way, that are still thinking whether we are in the Anthropocene or not. Public society. Civil society has already decided. Yes, we are in a world that, that can be fairly called Anthropocene. What does it mean in terms of solutions? That's a very important point. We don't know about the problems or the risks, but what about the solutions? And I would make the point that with an Anthropocene, the amount of solutions and we have to deliver this, also from a soil perspective. And then people say, well, this is, we have no chance because we need strong regulation. We can only regulate ourselves out of this mess. I would like to make the point that there is some reason in regulation, but there's also some reason in voluntary schemes. One last sentence for this.
I come after the last
sentence. Before the one with the time management.
It's very last sentence. I would like to raise the attention and awareness. Very last sentence is mankind will only survive on a voluntary basis. Thank you. Now I'm under pressure. A lot under pressure because Barbara told me his 5 minutes are a lot longer than my 5 minutes. So I would like to give you 1 more minute. On the question of the Anthropocene, because I need to build a bridge to IUCN, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. If we are living in the Anthropocene, these guys have that there's nothing to protect anymore, because there is no more nature, because everything is man-made. What is your take on this, so that Mark has a few minutes to think about, 1 minute to think about it?
Well, difficult question, I have to say. There is a lot of discussion around if we are already living in the Anthropocene. Okay, one can agree to it. Everything mankind made, the destruction is mankind made, then we really have, and this is what Günther Wachmann said, then we have to think about the solutions. And the solutions have to be much more radical. Yeah, much more radical in the sense to maintain what we call a planet that is still able to give us as humans the ability to live. I think the Earth, the planet itself, will continue to stay. Yeah, but it's not clear right now if this is going to be with us. That's the big question. If we extinct ourselves, that's of course true, then there is no IUCN anymore who has to do anything, but this is true for us as well.
I think this will be one of the debates of the future, the relationship between nature, man-made disaster, radical solutions, and how to live together. This is only one of the reasons why we are happy to have IUCN with us, one of the partners who have joined us for Global 2027. Of course, you all know everything about IUCN. In case you have forgotten it, I would like to mention 3 figures only. IUCN has 1,300 members. Doesn't sound so much in global scale, but among these members, there are 89 states. This increases the number of membership indirectly quite a bit. 180 government agencies and 1,100 NGOs. So a real broad global network. In the past, we always had the situation that IUCN was lobbying for protecting nature, that's your job. And the people from agriculture said, and the remaining land we are going to use in not such a sustainable way. We have invited IUCN to ask, what kind of change do we need? That in the end, we can feed people, 9 billion people, that we have enough space for protection of nature. What do we have to change in order to make both possible? I would like to invite Mark Smith from IUCN to come here to the floor, and you know, 5 minutes or 55 minutes.
Thank you so much. I'm, fortunately, I am
an optimist. And I work for ICN because it's a place where you can work on solutions to these very kinds of problems. But before I get to that, I wanted to make one comment. I wasn't able to be in the meeting yesterday, or the day before, so I've come in making these comments, having just listened to you for 1 hour or so. And my normal job in ICN is as the director for the Global Water Program. So normally I'm in the same kinds of discussions, just talking about water. And I found it hugely helpful and beneficial to come in to someone else's conversation, and recognize that I need to listen here for an hour. And so one of the lessons from that, for me, was for the SDGs and this objective of integration. We need to be willing to go to the other people's meetings and listen. So I've learned a lot in that hour this morning. For IUCN, we work a lot on promoting, alongside the government of Germany and others, the Bond Challenge on forest landscape restoration and land regulation neutrality and so on. So for IUCN, in this challenge of how do you find solutions that will enable nature and people to coexist in a healthy way, degradation and restoration are key issues, key parts of our program. And that's because it's important for production, as we've been talking about this morning, but it's also because it's these issues, overcoming degradation, addressing restoration, are important for biodiversity and for conservation. So one of our messages to a meeting like this is that we need to embrace the integration of ecosystem management and conservation and production. So challenge IUCN to include soil biodiversity as part of conservation, while at the same time challenging, if we can say, the production community to incorporate ecosystem functions into their plans, into their objectives. And therefore, one challenge I would make to the key messages that we've heard about, that were presented to us this morning, one of the messages talked about managing landscapes for people. Yes, fully agree that. We run programs to try and do that. But we do that managing landscape for people and nature, because the two work together. We do that using landscape approaches. So we promote and apply landscape approaches, and these are built around the kinds of global frameworks that we're talking about, that this HLPF will be talking about. But we help to translate that into action programs that can address work with national and subnational priorities. So building with stakeholders the technical packages that you need to deliver multiple benefits. So this is the next point is a really key thing. We must be sure not to let the high level political forum in July speak only about silence. Speak only about land restoration, for example, for carbon mitigation. We can't let them just talk in those terms. We have to make sure that they are speaking about land restoration for production and livelihoods and small and medium-sized enterprise and water security and ecosystems and biodiversity, equity and rights. We need to drive them to change the way they tackle policy, to change the way they speak, to embrace talking about systems. To embrace talking about systems and getting into complex issues. Now, the final point I wanted to make was just a reflection that I picked up from the IUCN Congress, which took place last September. IUCN Congress takes place every 4 years. We were there alongside Alexander, he was with us, and others. I was moderating one session with Achim Steiner, was a speaker, and at that time he was, and now he's the UNDP administrator, but in that moment he was a completely free person. So he just spoke his mind in our sessions, which was wonderful. And, the difference was, because he's also a former IUCN Director General, so he was among friends. And he was, rather than being talking within a political constraint, he was just telling us what he thought. And as a moderator in that session, I said we have to, it's too difficult for us in policy circles to talk about systems and complexity and the need to work with change in those contexts. And he said, no, we can do that. We have to do that. We must take on that challenge. So we have to build a better language for talking about systems, for talking about complexity, for taking on this integration challenge. And I say not letting forums like the HLPF get away with talking about single segmented solutions. So I want to finish by commending your five key messages that you will be taking to New York as important steps in helping to build a policy language around systems and talking about complexity and having a language for complexity. Because my view is, as I say, the reason I work for IUCN is because I think there's a lot of beauty left in planet Earth, and we can collectively make sure that it's still around and we're still around to enjoy.
Finalizing the key messages, maybe Mateos, what was the latest development on Slido?
Yeah, very clear. We have two questions or comments on this terminology of vulnerable people, suggestions of using including the wording of the SDGs themselves. So maybe this is a nice question to be discussed now. Should we give a more specific name to vulnerable people in message? I think it's message 4. Because it varies from country to country, from institution to institution. And I think Yes has something to say about this, yes. Or is still bringing one or two?
No, I think the one delivery is over.
So who wants to comment on it? I personally have seen that there's a development. The first was official UN documents, it was always included with a special focus on vulnerable people. And then they have been defined in a more clear way. Women, indigenous people, pastoralists, fisher folks, and I've learned forest dwellers and small-scale farmers. And then there was a new development to say, sorry, these people are not only vulnerable,
they are present.
They are actors. And I think we have to use it in a way that we do not fall back into what has been discussed 10 years ago. So the question is, how do we want to phrase it? Because we would like to have a focus in the key messages. Any opinion on it? And then I'm going to continue with the question of conservation of nature. I would like to have a discussion on elephants. Not Indian elephants and not African elephants, but maybe European and US American elephants, big companies. So Natalie, be prepared for 1 minute maximum to present your question. But first we are now working on what kind of language are we going to use. Yes, I'm able to throw the box through the whole room without hurting anybody.
Yes. But I'm all about.
I take the mic. Yes. It's less risky. So in line with what Mark from IUCN was talking about, at one point he mentioned integrated landscape management approach, and I think it's totally in line with what our colleague before was mentioning. I don't remember who he is now. But when he was talking about the territorial approach to food security, so we may consider in this point 2, this key message point 3, actually, like when we refer to spatial planning, maybe we may consider actually much more referring to integrated landscape approaches and initiatives that will actually, you know, like that most of them are defined by inclusive and participatory, you know, like governance.
Okay, thanks a lot.
On the wording of message 1, I think Juan or Delphine are the ones to propose words if there is anything else on that. I don't know if you want to check, or I don't see Delphine right now.
Just hand it over.
Okay. Juan? No? Flap your notebooks?
So now, Natalie, you mentioned, let's talk about the elephant in the room. This is, by the way, the hidden beauty of Slido.
Yeah.
If you you make comments, you have to be aware that we are going to bring you on stage and say, sorry, I don't understand it. What do you want to talk about, the elephants? What is your real issue?
It is a real issue.
Hello, my name is Natalie Knapp. I'm working at Bulletin. And what we see is that there are, what we haven't or not discussed yet a lot, is that the fact that there are so many mergers going on at this moment. Like Bayer Monsanto, also called Bayer Santo already, by some activists. Dow and Syngenta and Chem China. And I was wondering, they are already also on very strategic positions within the UN system. So I would like to discuss this and how they influence sustainable land management and restoration.
Okay, two additional comments, one directly here. Be careful, don't hurt anybody. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, me and the group of Rights and Resources Initiative, just to add on to this excellent comment, it's not just about mergers among two companies, it's about, you know, treating states and companies as separate entities. I think that's often a fallacy. So the level of collusion among certain companies and states can be quite significant, and it's not just in context with governance context that might be weak or fragile. We can look even to the country of residence where Trump's corporate interests, right, are influencing some tendencies to influence some of his own policies. So I'd like us to think about it in terms of multiple dimensions, both among companies and then many states and companies and state-owned enterprises and the many forms that the cooperation or collusion among the entities.
Any other comment? You know, this is a tricky question. We all tend to agree, and of course, elephants are dangerous, therefore this picture is very nice. But my question is, what do we think about how the SDGs can be implemented? We are talking about trillions of dollars of investment, but of course, this investment has to be done in the right way. And therefore, one of the first messages was looking at responsible, sustainable investments. So I think one of the debates we should have in the near future is how to ensure that the investments in sustainability is really going to follow the SDGs and is not just investment business as usual without any guidance towards sustainability. And you have seen that I have asked someone if he is ready to provide a contribution. I would like to invite Klaus Töpfer because he was leading an independent team of advisors to the ECOSOC in New York. Exactly on the question, what kind of investment do we need to achieve sustainability? Klaus, you have to talk. Yeah, yes.
Well, thank you very much. First and foremost, it's great to be not active but only listening. That's a new old, and I'm happy about that. But to add some words, wherever you are in the system right now, you just discuss finance, you will have directly the link that finance cannot only come from public funding but from private business. Look at the discussion on the Green Climate Fund. You can look wherever you want. It is very clear. Maybe that you had a report of a speech in the discussion with the president of the World Bank. If you read this, you see that he is asking for a new business case of the World Bank. That the World Bank is not responsible for the money, but the brokering, the honest broker for money. It's totally new structure. Totally new structure. And by the way, not by chance. Not by chance. If you go around, you see that we have linked with the nationalization of policies. Also something like a huge increase of the liberal ideas and then to come back to private business and investment. My concern is when you go to developing countries and you know I was quite a long time in wonderful Kenya and Nairobi, the image investment is very negative. Very negative. So how do we bridge this gap? On the one side, you see in the average donor countries more and more running short of their own obligations. If you see it in Europe, don't ask me for all the arguments why Germany right now is not in the same situation. They are quite happy. See, that makes us a little bit of an exotic sound. In my finance minister, we have to pay a much. There's much too much money in the world. Much too much money. But on the wrong time. How can you bring it? If you go to the developed country and say, but then you have to increase taxes, you are very sure that what the last election would win. It's true, honestly. If you discuss consumption patterns, I would strongly recommend in the next local soil week, we should have at least 5 excursions in German supermarkets. It is really, it would be a mistake if somebody comes from Africa and is not going through a German supermarket. By chance, I was yesterday in one of those, and I want to buy some goods. Being in Africa, a wonderful experience. So there are names, if you did this time. I could choose between names from Chile, from Brazil, from India, from Namibia, and South Africa. In one people. So you have a little bit the answer to your question. These are not the small farmers making this. These are global markets. And I feed our only food, only food. And if we see the price for this, I come back to those questions, what is a fair price? What is a fair price? And by the way, who is going to pay a fair price for food? When I grew up, an average family, yes, in those days, the average family had 3 kids. Now the average family in Germany is a little bit smaller. In any case, in those days, we had to pay from our income nearly 50% of food. What do you believe is the average expenditure from the income right now? It's around 10%. And if you see the prices, for example, for milk here, it is a shame because they must use production cattle which are able to bring milk in a quantity that it can have at those prices. So, it is easy to say that the big elephants are the reason for that. Be careful. Be careful. Because at the end of the day, we have exactly to answer the question, how can we make private money work for the development again? That's it. I could go a little bit further, but I don't know more. And by the way, wonderful. I'm jealous.
That I said, you will stay there.
By the way, I was jealous how wonderfully you are scoring this. Was that for a week exercise? Anyhow, you see, our recommendation to United Nations. There is, of course, a paradigm shift. Until now, the United Nations system, the MIFID system, was always organized from north to south. MDGs, fascinating, north to south. The north is okay, their development pattern is something like the blueprint for the rest of the world. At least we do it. And then you go, but with some success, no doubt. No doubt. Now, by the way, as you all know, coming from the south, people come back with the minimum, but you are not sustainable at all in the north as well. So it is a globalized process. If you have a globalized process, you must be also aware that there are additional consequences. The Günter Bachmann and German Council made a wonderful proposal. And luckily, in the meantime, that's common policy here, that the SDGs are not only to implement in Germany, but also by Germany and with Germany. So that is our total responsibility. And that has something to do also with our NIA activity with the government money. Right now, in Germany, a little bit, as I mentioned, exotically unequivocal, much too good conditions. And therefore, the chair is empty, but I hope that after the election, you have the same person sitting on the same chair. But of course, we are going to have election. So I could say that this election really commended, because there was also, in what you mentioned, the learning of coordination, or with President Ethiopia. You see, I was 8 years in the UN. The most relevant word was coordination. And the result was chaos. Each and everybody asks for coordination and nobody wants to be coordinated. That's the question. So what we are recommending is not coordination without authority, but what we need is coordination with authority, that you can be responsible for implementing the coordination treaty, otherwise it is a difficult situation. So our final report, by the way, is published as well. The file is under the headline, Outcome of CEO Spending, the world we want, and we ask to end in it. And this is a time when the UN is anyhow under a huge, huge pressure. Looks at the development of the United States of America. And I mentioned it yesterday with one word. We are in a crisis of multilateralism. We are discussing here all topics which are only solvable with multilateralism. So I would strongly recommend that we add some ideas in a preamble, what have you, what we need for implementing the SDGs as a strong UN. A strong UN. And hopefully this could make a little bit better the perspectives we will see, the change in the climate, only in some weeks near Germany at the G20. That is one of the first tastes for what we have to do.
We started with the elephant, and we got the recommendation, don't ignore the elephant, but try to tame it, try to guide it, try to make it useful for implementing the SDGs. And as a consequence, I think we should add to our messages kind of an introductory remark, that no country in the world can solve the problems on its own way, and therefore we need a strong multilateral system, but also a different multilateral system looking at it. We will also, as a consequence of your input, change the messages, and we add also sustainable production, including the biophysical side. That's very clear, and it should have been there in the first place, and this was only my fault. It was 1 hour after midnight. You were dancing, I was typing, and I was my mistake. Second, we are going to add the territorial approach, not spatial planning, that's a nice word, but territorial approach is better. We are talking about a mind shift, shifting consciousness. We have already changed the wording with rights, right holders, and describing the vulnerable, the communities. There has to be a trade and investment involved. And then the messages will be a bit longer, but we try to do it in a way that they continue to convey messages and they are not little reports which no one is going to read. In the beginning, we said, why are we going to go to New York to the high-level political forum in July this year? Of course, this is not the only target, and I would like to invite our friend and partner from UNCCP, because the idea is we would like to build a bridge between SDG 2, negotiated in New York, or reviewed in New York 2017, to the High Level Political Forum in 2018,
much for the opportunity. I think we need to, first of all, say that as a UNCCD, we believe in partnerships. Our family is very small, but we believe in networks and expanding our reach through partners ourselves. So we do definitely support these SDGs, coming these proposals to go to the high-level platform, because we believe that together, as I said, on Monday, we can go very far. All right? Alone, we just go very fast. Okay. So I think these are good points to bring to the high-level high-level platform. But I would, given what has been said here already by numerous interventions, suggest that perhaps recommendation number one, we should add perhaps the issue of land, the use part of it, because use and governance, they go hand in glove. So they can listen to me. So I will say that number one, we believe that recommendation number one to the high-level platform should include use before governance, because use and governance they're like hand in glove, especially when you're talking about the issues of land. I hope many of you agree with me. And we are very happy that land degradation neutrality has found its way to number five, and we really want to thank. We stand ready at the UNCCD, because we have a liaison office in New York, to partner with yourselves all the way to the wire. Yesterday, there was a question, a proposal, very useful, that was made by one of the distinguished delegates here around the Friends of Land, right? The proposal was the Friends of Land. And it was also mentioned by one of our colleagues that there is actually Friends of GLTT, Land Degradation. And that is the business we do in the UNCCD, like a certain money. So I want to say to you guys, that colleagues, that yes, that group is still functional. It is in New York. It is co-chaired by Iceland and Namibia. And it's got 23 countries at this point. Yeah. I could have read them.
Thank you very much. I believe we have all embraced the cube, loved it, shared, and our key messages have been enriched by this dialogue. Thank you very much for all the contributions. We are now clear on the process. Alexander was good enough at the beginning to lay out what's going to happen. We are also clear on the obligations that we have as individuals to the constituencies we are accountable to. Take it to the people. After taking it to the people, it's to New York.
Well, I was just wondering, I'm super happy that you say that everything is clear with the process, so maybe I can say one or two words about what we're going to do after, but when you want.
Right now.
Oh, when that happens, just especially May, don't you?
Yep.
So what will happen now, and it's very much connected to what you were saying, Jons, and thank you so much for declaring the support of UNCCD for when we take these messages to New York. So if you allow me for 30 seconds, in case you're interested in what's going to happen also after the Global Week and what we're going to do with everything that we have discussed here, then I want you just to share maybe two or three ideas on how you can also be engaged in the process leading up to the high-level political forum, how you can be involved in the SDGs. And we will make sure that all of this information is on our website, so please, if I mention websites or names and acronyms, don't be concerned with that, so we're going to try to put it up. So the first thing that we think is important to highlight and how we are going to bring the messages from here to New York was, of course, the fact that Thomas Sass was here from UNDESA and would hear from us directly what we want and why we think soils are so important for the process. At the same time, as has been mentioned a couple of times, we have applied, and also thanks to the support of the German government for a side event. And this has been applied for as an official German government side event. But of course, we are also hoping, and we're also already in discussions with our government co-hosts for the Global Soul Week, to keep their support also to bring these messages forward at the UN. And these would be, okay, you know that, of course, you know the HLBF is from the 10th to the 19th of July in New York. But these, of course, we want to have on the days that SDGs 1 and 2 will be discussed, because it's at the beginning and because it comes, of course, closer, but we can already build the linkages to the other SDGs that we have discussed here on gender, on health, on infrastructure, etc. So these will happen there, and what we will want to present there is, number one, the 5 messages that Lindy will present and that you have so gracefully already improved in the process of these discussions. But we also want to take physical copies of the larger report of the Global Soul Week. We say that that's going to be about 30 to 50 pages so that we can do justice to everything that was discussed. And there we will also include some reflections on the method, what we did here, who was at the table, who wasn't here with us, what could be done better. And this is what is going to be discussed in the closing plenary that GS will facilitate. And so it would be really great if you, of course, come back for that so that you can help us already reflect on what we did here and what lessons we can draw from that. So those 2 things, the policy messages and the larger reports we want to present at the site. Also, I want to make sure that you also know that you can get involved and be yourself hopefully there. So there's a call out from UNDESA, from the UN now, for speakers for the official program of the HLPF. And this is open on their website until the 26th of May. And anybody can nominate themselves or somebody else to be there and to present something relevant to the topic of the HLPF. And of course, they offer some financial support to some participants, so I encourage you to have a look at the prerequisites there and how you can participate and engage. There's also the call for participation, general participants of the HLPF, and that is open until June 8th for the organizations that have some special status and others. There's all the information on them on how you can be involved. And for that, and last thing, 2 things are important. Number one is that the draft program of the HLPF is already out and on the website, so you can have a look at how they will address the manned reviews. And it's really interesting because that compares and gives us information about how we did it here and how they are planning to do it there and what we can support them with. And the second one is that some of the national voluntary review reports are already also online. So not all of the 44 countries have already put them up, but some are up. Benin is up. So we can actually go on the website and you can already start checking, and that's the most useful way to really get engaged, is to review your countries or other countries' reports and then make specific comments on them and how they can be improved. So we hope, of course, to see many, many of you there, and we really, really hope that we can together put these messages forward, because it doesn't make any sense if it's only the organizers putting it there. It should really come from all of us, with our governments taking the lead. So thank you for that.
Are also here. We are in it together. Well done for a great performance and great output. We are going to break for the coffee, tea, fun, comfort break. And at 11:30, we are going to reconvene for a very, very special event where our very own icon is being honored. The award, and we are going to be graced by the State Secretary of Environment and the President of the International Union of Soil Scientists. So please, your time, take 11:25 for 11:30. Thank you very much. My take home, baked beans, pumpkins. What you take home? Enjoy.